Hey friends, how are you all? My name is Harshit Dwivedi and I welcome you back to my video. So in this video friends, I will be talking with you regarding the Congress Socialist Party. This was formed in 1934, especially at a time, you know, when this civil disobedience movement has ended. At this point of time, this Congress Socialist Party was started. Important persons associated with this party were J.P. Narayan, Meenu Masani and Achar Narendra Dev. This is presented by me, Harshit Dwivedi. You can also follow me if you like on Instagram. The link of my Instagram profile is given in the description box below. Also, this is the English version of the video, friends. If you are comfortable with the Hindi version of the video, if you want to watch that, the link of the Hindi version of the video is given in the description box below. So you can also watch that, friends. So starting with it, when the civil disobedience movement was on at its full flow, what happened? That many leaders of the Indian National Congress were arrested, and at present time they were languishing in jail. Now most of them were in jail. The people who were associated with the formation of Congress Socialist Party, they had an ideology, and their ideology didn't match with the ideology of either Communist Party of India or Gandhiji. At that point of time, the other important party other than Indian National Congress was Muslim League, and there was one more party named as the Communist Party of India, which believed in the principles of core socialism. Now, these people who were associated with the formation of this Congress Socialist Party, they were not very much impressed by the approach of Gandhiji. Actually, they didn't like Gandhiji's approach, because Gandhiji, when the movement was at its peak, they said that when the civil disobedience movement was at its peak, you just withdrawn it. The reason being for the Gandhi Irwin Pact and participation in the second roundtable conference, where the non-cooperation movement was at peak due to the Charichara movement, it was withdrawn. So these people were saying that this actually they believed that nothing useful is going to come out of the Britishers like this. Negotiation is not going to help. And also the Gandhian methods, they didn't favor the Gandhian methods of non-violence, charkha, khadi. This was not to their people's, these people's liking. Also, these Congress Socialist Party people, they were also not happy with the ideology of Communist Party of India, because this Communist Party of ideology was very sectarian. They were just leaning towards the peasants and the labor class. And All India Congress Socialist Party, despite believing in the principles of socialism, wanted to keep their endeavor a bit wide across all the sections of the Indian society. Now, these people who were the supporters of this All India Congress Socialist Party, they were the supporter of Fabianism and Marxism-Leninism. Now, what this Fabianism means? Fabianism is the principles of democratic socialism by gradualist and reformist efforts in democracies rather than by revolutionary overthrow. They say that, okay, democratic socialism should be there, and it should be obtained through reform and gradually, not by revolutionary overthrowing the leading class. So this was the ideology of Fabianism. Now, what led to the formation of the Socialist Party? This is a million-dollar question. What was happening that when civil disobedience movement was going on, a lot of leaders were arrested and many of them were lodged in the Nasik jail. So in this Nasik jail, J.P. Narayan met Ram Manohar Lohia. Ram Manohar Lohia is a very famous personality, friends. Especially in UP, you will find many hospitals named after him and many other things. Schools, colleges, many things are named after Dr. Ram Manohar Lohia. Then hospitals in special. Then Meenu Masani, Achyut Patwardhan, Ashok Mehta, Yusuf Desai. So all these leaders met, and they were actually not happy with Gandhiji, because Gandhiji suddenly withdrew this civil disobedience movement to participate in the second round table conference, especially at a time when the civil disobedience movement was its full force. Now what happened in April 1934, J.P. Narayan and Meenu Masani were released from the jail. Then Ram Briksh Beni Puri and J.P. Narayan convened a meeting in Patna on 17th of May 1934. And at this place, and on this date, Bihar Congress Socialist Party was established. Now, as the name suggests, it has a Bihar in it. So it was basically a regional party. This Bihar Congress Socialist Party, its general secretary became J.P. Narayan, and Achar Narendra Dev became its president. Now, after the formation of this Bihar Congress Socialist Party, the stage was set up for an All India Party, and then happened the Bombay Conference on 22nd of October and 23rd of October 1934, where an All India Party, the Congress Socialist Party, was formed. Its general secretary was J.P. Narayan, and Meenu Masani became its joint secretary, friends. Okay. Now, this All India Congress Socialist Party, actually it was not a separate party. It was said that it will function as a wing, as an organ of the Indian National Congress. And the one eligibility of being a member of the All India Congress Socialist Party that you should have the membership of Indian National Congress. So it is not a separate from Indian Congress. It was designated to function as a member of, or as a, you know, part of Indian National Congress only. Also, when this party, All India Congress Socialist Party, was formed, a lot of congressmen inside the Indian National Congress, especially the Swarajist faction, they were not very happy with it. Because they were of a view that formation of this All India Congress Socialist Party within the Indian National Congress is going to divide the Indian National Congress. The Swarajist and the Socialist elements of the Indian National Congress, they were not agreed on a common set of views on a many number of issues. Those issues involved, for example, Government of India Act of 1935, then the formation of ministries in 1937, organization of Kisan Sabhas, agitation in the Indian states. So on all these issues, the Swarajist and Socialist elements were not able to engage with each other. Okay. Also, this Socialist Party and Gandhiji were also in a sort of opposite direction. Gandhiji and Socialists were actually anti to each other. How? See, J.P. Narayan was a representative of Socialist Party. He said, Gandhism has played its part. It cannot carry us further, and hence we must march and guide it by the ideology of Socialism. He said that, okay, this Gandhism philosophy, actually, this is... has played its part, it has done some things in the past, but now it is not useful, and in order to move forward, now we should follow the ideology of Socialism. In his part, what Mahatma Gandhi said, Mahatma Gandhi ji was completely against this Congress Socialist Party. He made it clear that if Congress Socialist Party gained ascendancy in the Congress, he would not remain in the Congress. He did not approve of class war, exploitation and violence. Gandhi ji straightforwardly said that I don't like this Congress Socialist Party, and if the influence of Congress Socialist Party increases inside the Indian National Congress, then I am going to leave this Indian National Congress. Because he said that whatever principles this Congress Socialist Party are following, it will lead us to class war, expropriation and violence, and Gandhiji was at any cost against violence. There were many more influential members of Indian National Congress like Jawaharlal Nehru, Subhash Chandra Bose. Now, Jawaharlal Nehru, Subhash Chandra Bose had very leftist views, and they were very much supportive of socialism. Both of them were a supporter of socialism, and they actually also supported the formation of this Congress Socialist Party, but they actually never joined it formally. They supported the formation of Congress Socialist Party, they supported the views of socialism, but they never joined this party formally. Jawaharlal Nehru was especially a very big supporter of socialism, and when he was presiding, elected as the president of the 1936 Lucknow session of the Indian National Congress, he said this: I see no way of ending the poverty, vast unemployment, degradation and subjection of the Indian people except through socialism. It involves vast revolutionary changes in our political and social structure, ending vested interest in the land and industry, as well as the feudal autocratic Indian state system. It has means that means ending private system by the ideal idols of corporate society. So what does this statement say? This statement says that Jawaharlal Nehru says that our country has such vast poverty, unemployment, degradation and subjection of Indian people is there. So all these things cannot be removed except by the principles of socialism. So for that, huge revolutionary changes are required in our political and social structure. Also, private profit system should be ended, and highest ideals of this cooperative services should be deployed. Moving forward, friends, in 1936, at the Lucknow session of the Indian Congress, when Jawaharlal Nehru was the president, he included three Congress socialists in his Congress Working Committee. They included Jayaprakash Narayan, Acharya Narendra Dev and Achyut Patwardhan. There was also one more present, that was Subhash Chandra Bose. Also, this the view of All India Congress Socialist Party was something like this, that it was not in favor of giving conditional support to the Britishers in the Second World War. They were actually not in favor of giving any support to the Britishers when the Second World War was going on. They said that they have got an opportunity and they should strike back hard on the Britishers. Also, these All India Congress Socialist Party supporters, they wanted to change the society gradually and with reforms. But not by the Gandhian ideology. kindly mind. And not by the core CPI ideology, because the core Communist Party of India ideology will propound revolutionary overthrow. So they were also not looking for this. So actually they were looking for something in between. They also said that Hindu-Muslim unity is important, and Hindu-Muslim unity can only be obtained when these economic issues are taken care of. Now see friends, the whole concept of socialism is based on this economic issues. Socialism says that until and unless the working class is having its economic issues solved, their problems will not be solved. So obviously they said that if Hindus and Muslims both have good financial status, if their economic issues are solved, if they have good to live, good to eat, then obviously they are not going to fight with each other. So they gave a simple logic that this Hindu-Muslim unity can be obtained by solving this economic issues problem. Now actually this is very generalization, friends. We very well know that despite solving the economic issues, the whole problem of Hindu-Muslim unity cannot be solved at that point of time. So we all can say that at this point the All India Congress Socialist Party was wrong. Now we should look at the agenda of the Congress Socialist Party. It actually adopted in principle the development of economic life of the country. Obviously economic life of the country should be developed by the state. It should be planned by the state. No private participation should be there. That is, the development of the economic life of the country should be planned by the state. 1 minute, friends. Okay, now state should have the monopoly of foreign trade. Cooperative society should be organized for production, distribution and credit in the unorganized sector of the economic life. That is, these cooperative societies which work on a not-for-profit basis, they should be mobilized in the unorganized sector so that the production, distribution, this can take on in an efficient manner. Foreign trade, state monopoly should be there. And obviously the whole complete strata of economic life, that should be devised centrally by the state, that is by the government. Okay, no private participation should be there, because if private participation would be there, so a private person will look his own interest, his own of profit. He will not look at the interest of the people, the public, the society. He will look at his own profit. So actually this central planning should be done by the state. Then it's also adopted the in principle redistribution of land. Now what does this mean, friends? Redistribution of land among the peasant. It said that all privately owned land should be taken away by the state from the owner, and then that land should be redistributed among the peasants. Also, if the workers and peasants have taken any loans, any debts, so those debts should be liquidated. They should be waived off. Also, workers and peasants should be organized in such a manner for their economic eclipse, so that achievement of independence can be there and socialism can also be there. So all this is sort of a Bol Bachchan type of things, friends. Just need to know that economic uplift was their main agenda. Improving the living standard of the workers and peasants, improving their financial positions was one big agenda of this thing. Also, in principle, socialization of key industries, insurance and public utilities is also one thing. See, public utilities is something, friends. For example, providing the basic essential public services. Now, that cannot be given into the private hand. Even in today's India and today's United States of America, this is not completely in the hands of the private sector. This is in the hands of the government. Because government can only provide things according to the requirements of the people. If a private sector is going to engage in this, they are going to charge high rates. Or obviously, they will not interest. They will work according to their profit, friends. Okay. So socialization of key industries, insurance should be there, public utilities should be there, and all this production, distribution and exchange, its progressive socialization could be done, so that big thought process of how the people's life can be done better should be there, and capitalist class should not be involved because they will think only for their profits. Also, the state was called upon to encourage and control cooperative and collective farming. So this cooperative and collective farm, what it is, I will be going to tell you in the separate video. This is a big thing, friends. So cooperative and collective farming will be noticed. In this, you know, land was owned by the government. A lot of peasants will come together. They will, do everything agriculture they will do. And finally, the produce will be distributed among all of them. And also this Bombay session, it adopted separate programs for workers and peasants. Now see what programs were adopted for what. For workers, the demand were that they should have the freedom to form trade unions and they should have the right to go to the strike. They should get a decent living wage. In a week, 40 hours for which should be provided. And they should have insurance against sickness, unemployment, accident, and old age. If any of this occurs, they should be given some money. For the peasants, for demands that landlordism and zamindari should be abolished. Cooperative farming should be encouraged. Also, on uneconomic holdings, rents and taxes should be exempted. What were uneconomic holdings, friends? Also, those lands from which a good amount of agricultural produce is coming, so they will become economic. But on those lands on which agriculture is not prosperous, friends, on those lands, rents and taxes should not be taken, and obviously these feudal levies should be abolished. Now, what happened? They also, these All India Congress Socialist Party supporters, they also argued that independence can be achieved only by the direct struggle of the masses. Okay, now masses should struggle directly. Obviously, that struggle should be gradual. Okay, that struggle should be reformist, but that should be direct. It is not based on the principles of non-violence. That is why they didn't support Gandhiji. And they said that the Second World War has given us a golden opportunity to do the same, because this government is in pressure and this is the time to strike back on the governments. And that is why they said that direct struggle should be there. They organized mass revolutionary activities, and their mass revolutionary activities considerably increased, especially during the Quit India movement, friends. So this was a complete analysis of this All India Congress Socialist Party, friends. It actually followed the principles of socialism, but it wanted to include all the elements of the society within its ambit. It just didn't want to confine itself to the class of peasants and workers. So this was All India Congress Socialist Party, friends. I hope this video was helpful for you. It transformed itself into quite a big video. I didn't want it to make it so big, but it had a lot of contents. All the ideology, thought process, you can say strategy, everything related to All India Congress Socialist Party, I have already told you. I hope this video was really helpful for you, friends. If this video was really helpful for you, kindly subscribe to my channel, friends. Also, if you like this video, please give this video a like. If you don't like, you can dislike this video, but please tell me in the comment section below that what errors you find in this video, friends, and if possible, please suggest this videos more and more to your friends, because more the number of views of my videos, more it inspires me to make more and more good content like this. Also, this content is in English, friends. So if you're not comfortable in English and if you want to watch this video in Hindi, then you can go to the Hindi version of the video. The link of it is given in the description box below. So thank you for watching my video, friends. Thank you for being patient. Have a very, very nice day. Take care.